Hello all, welcome. So this talk is more about so far we heard about conversations on localized problem solving around hyperlocal problem statements or in the last mile delivery problems or even the vehicle routing problems in the last mile, right? So this talk is more about the background before entering into the last mile, and it will be heavily on the context of the e-commerce or a marketplace kind of scenario, right? So my name is Senthil. A quick introduction about me. My name is Senthil. I'm a product manager in Flipkart. I have worked in several supply chain problems all the way from the very start of Flipkart having its own supply chain till now. A quick update on the flow of the conversation will be, like, first is about talking about the landscape that we operate. What are the dynamics of the landscape? What are the dynamics of the landscape that is coming outside as a demand, and what is the dynamics of the landscape that we operate within the business? Second is about what is the key problem statements in this domain. So there is a bunch of problem statements that we look at it, and how the network intelligence as a subject or a concept is well positioned in this overall scheme of things. And finally, if time permits, we'll also talk about an illustration of a particular use case or a particular problem statement and see how we have evolved in that direction. That's the overall part of the overall journey for this conversation. First, to start with an operating landscape, right? Step one is from a Flipkart or e-commerce marketplace scenario, the categories that we operate is humongous. So these are some of the typical examples that I can quote here, is like books, which is very different from the way it operate for which we operate. It's very different from the way we operate books to furniture, or it could be large appliances, or it could be grocery, and so on. Entering into jewellery and new subjects like that. So the product categories comes with different dynamics altogether. The dynamics in terms of working capital management, the margin that it operates, the consumer demand it generates, and the kind of consumer expectation that it generates is very, very different. Not only that, this product also has very different types of attributes, right? For example, if I want to deliver furniture to your house, it's not one product that need to be delivered. It could be multiple parts that need to be delivered, or it could be some of the damaged parts that need to be delivered with this, which could be a replacement of a part, rather than the whole product itself. Or it could be, some of the products could be fragile. For example, it's a wall clock. It need to be handled with care. Also, the stacking norms of the product differs across the categories, right? And so on and so forth. The managing of products could be in lots, or it could be in niches, or it could be high value and inflammation, or it could be a hazardous product, and so on and so forth. The third dynamic that we talk about is customer segments. The customer segment that we operate is pan-India, right? With a variety of customer categories they come from. For example, we just launched a Plus program, which is our loyalty program. So there's a differentiation between the Plus and non-Plus customers. There's a tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 customers. There's metro customers. There's millennials that we operate. There's a women population that we operate with different age groups and so on and so forth, right? The important subject here is that these customers have different needs when they look at an e-commerce platform. And when you intermingle that with the products and the kind of dynamics the product brings in, the e-commerce platform is pushed to deliver a lot of new services. It's not just vanilla delivery that we do, place an order, get it delivered. It opens up a variety of new supply chain services that is required. It could be scheduled delivery, next day delivery, or it could be faster speed, like same day delivery, slotted delivery. We talked about some of the, in the morning conversation, we talked about scheduled delivery in the last mile areas. It also could be installation. We do furniture and other stuff which requires installation. Reverse pickups, open box delivery, so on and so forth, right? Grocery, it could be a very different thing. If we enter into the house and deliver things, right, compared to something else. So there are a variety of supply chain services. Not only that, it also can, since some of the deliveries could be much, much longer in lead time, like it could be 3 days or 5 days and so forth, the customer needs also change between that order journey. From the time of order placement to all the way to deliver, he can change the address, or it could be changing the delivery location, date, place, and so on and so forth, right? So the variety of supply chain services get intermingled. And finally, to operate all these things, the fulfillment models that we work in an e-commerce marketplace is very different. It is not always an inventory and we deliver to the location. It is also about sellers managing their own inventory and partnering with the sellers to deliver the products. It could be brands who is managing the inventory for a variety of marketplaces, not only for Flipkart. How do you interplay with them? Or ready to make orders? For example, if we are launching jewelry, it could be ready to make orders that we want to deliver to the customer. And so on and so forth. Omnichannel, hyperlocal. Flipkart is in grocery these days. So we are in hyperlocal. We are looking at hyperlocal and omnichannel business in a very close fashion, right? So there are multiple fulfillment models that can be operated for this kind of customer demand. All this thing comes with the one important part of demand volatility. What is demand volatility here is that the demand variation that we see in a marketplace scenario or in an e-commerce scenario is very high, very, very high in terms of, it is also induced as well as received. The induced part is that we run a lot of sale events. Recently we finished our Big Billion Days, and when we, so that the scale that we operate on a Big Billion is maybe 5x or 6x of the range that we operate in a BAE scenario. So it comes with a very different demand volatility into the picture. The second, given this operating landscape, right? When we look at supply chain, how does the supply chain look like? Right? We operate hundreds of warehouses with millions of products in the warehouses. We have hundreds and thousands of sellers who is partner in the entire e-commerce story for us. These partners not only spread across the country, and the customers also across the country. The supply chain here is not catering to a very specific location. It is from all the way from warehouse to seller to any number of pin codes in the country, right? So it is from all the possibility, from all the 20K pin codes, the source could be at all the 20K pin codes, and the customer or the destination could be all the 20K pin codes. So that's the kind of supply chain network that we are talking about here. So all these things are delivered through people, vehicles, and those are the currencies of operations. So if I look at the people part, we manage a large fleet force, co-owned, partnered, and so on and so forth, right? So the number of fleet force that we manage is also humongous with different skill set. It's not a specific, it's not only a delivery skill set. We look at installation, we look at people etiquette. There's a grocery delivery where we are doing delivery inside the warehouse, inside the house of the customer with the very different things. While a book delivery requires a very different etiquette in front of the customer, right? So the skill set of this field force varies a lot. And second, the next part is about the partners and vendors. The entire supply chain, when we connect all these 20K pin codes to all the other 20K pin codes in the country, it's not only a job that Flipkart can march forward, we also need the partners and vendors who can play a very key role in taking us forward in the journey. Right? So Aditya also mentioned about the millions of packets that we deal in a network, right? So if you look at our network at any point in time, there's more than a million of parcels that's moving around. And from all these sources and all these destinations, the routing of this parcel become much more important. We operate across multiple operating methods. So today, Jairam was talking about the truck testing. So we operate on more than thousands in the scale of thousands of trucks that we manage, bikes, our own large line haul vehicles. We also partner with cargo movers through flight and train and all those. Vehicle modes, all the transportation modes is also part of the story. Right? Finally, it's not only about the physics that we move around, there's also a lot of cash that moves around this entire network. It's in tens of crores of cash is getting dealt every day. It's also closer to a bank supply chain. Right? So that's the amount of cash because of the COD or the cash on delivery nature of the business. That's the amount of cash that we deal. So another interesting part is that this also comes with supply volatility, right? So for example, a vehicle can get broke down, or it could be an external climatic condition that is changing, or it could be the absenteeism that we are seeing in a particular location, or it could be a festivals and holidays and so on and so forth. So it all brings up the overall supply volatility picture to us, along with the demand volatility picture that we saw in the previous slide. So what does all indicate to us, right? It indicates, this is a point I want to take a step back and look at what is network. So network can be defined in various contexts. In a supply chain, a network means it is the all the elements that we saw in the previous slide, right? The sellers, warehouses, vehicles, people, partners, vendors, and all the stuff that is included, along with our own facilities, the delivery hubs, people call it the dispatch centers, and so on and so forth. So all these things form the part of the network. Now, as Flipkart grew up, Flipkart also had a very fast scaling of things. So it is like, when do you employ intelligence vis-a-vis, how do you fast scale? So that's a trade-off conversation that we usually have. So in the initial days when we had this growth, what we did is that we operated mostly from the inventory model. So if the incoming demand in a variation form, when it comes to us, every order is pushed into a warehouse. So remember, we talked about millions of packet, and this is very close to how our warehouse looks like. From warehouse, it has to get sorted all the way to the 20K pin codes that we talked about. So it's a sortation in itself is a very huge problem. So sortation, let me give you one snapshot about sortation. It's not about connecting one product to 20,000 pin codes. Every product has different nature. So we talked about furniture. We talked about grocery. Every product has requires a different level of sortation. Above that, we also apply new services to customer, right? We talked about next day delivery. Same day delivery, installation, all those things, when they couple together, the sortation in itself is a huge subject that opens up a lot of complexity to us. So if we push orders to a warehouse and we start processing the orders get piled up, right? Waiting for a transport connection to arrive at some point in time. And when you see the piling orders, and when you design a transport connection given a piling orders, your transport network looks much more complex. And if you're doing it in an instantaneous manner, it will always lead to a load. It's all in the industry term is LTL. We use load truck load, which reduces our efficiency and utilization, cost utilization significantly down. While we are all managing this, we also had implications because of not employing intelligence into this way of working, which is customers screaming at us and cost increasing exponentially. So there are a few snapshots about how customer concerns come to us, right? Most of the customer's problem is, where is my order, right? And when you look at this piling network and we say where it is stuck, and if I'm not able to give him a right answer, he's going to scream at me back every now and then, right? The second problem is that most of the time it's also coupled with all the last mile problems that Aditya talked about, fake attempt and so on and so forth. So managing the entire network is in itself a complex subject, right? So then that's the first point I want to do. And second step is that when we step back and look at this entire network, which we talked about connecting all the hundreds of thousands of sellers and along with our warehouse to all the way to the customer. So it's not a push-based model where you get an order, you operate, you push into a warehouse and process this works. So we need to step back and look at what are our push-ins or what are the problem statements that we need to rethink to develop an intelligent module above this. So that's Albert Einstein talking about how important it is to stay with the problem. It's more about thinking about the problem and getting in the right frame of the problem statement, much more important than actually getting into the solving it. Solving it could be much more simpler when you think about a problem statement of this kind that we talked about. So let me talk about some of the directional problems that we as an organization started thinking about. Step one, for every order, what is the fulfillment model that will be rightly operated? Should I engage a marketplace model here, or should I engage into an inventory model? How does this frame of what fulfillment model need to be operated for an order comes out? The second is, how should the inventory be reserved in a network? So I have a bunch of warehouses, I have a bunch of sellers, I have a bunch of inventory roaming around in my network. So where should I position my inventory, or where should I reserve my inventory for a given order? Right? If I'm understanding the inventory reservation part, what should be, when should I release the inventory? Should I release immediately, like the thing that we saw previously where we saw the inventory get reserved in a warehouse and it can immediately choke into a sortation, or it can lead to a very inefficient transportation mechanism? So should the orders be processed in a real-time basis, or should we batch it, wait for some information and start processing it? What should be the shipment flow path? So we have a variety of nodes. For example, if I want to connect from Bangalore to all the way to Guwahati, what should be the path that I should? Should I stop in Kolkata and go all the way to Guwahati, or should I employ a transport from all the way from Bangalore to Guwahati, or should we fly to Guwahati? There are a lot of options that we have, right? So assessing this shipment flow path is much more important for me. And then across, we talked about the exception that can happen, which is the variability. For example, a customer can say that I don't want this order anymore, or he can say that I want the order to be delivered to some other day, or it could be a climatic condition playing a role in its part, where we need to be answerable to customer in a more deterministic manner, right? So how do we take this exception? How do we build insights about this exception and answer the customer queries more predictable manner? And other things would be, is that when should I start a transport connection vendor? Should I start a truck immediately from a Bangalore, or from a Bangalore warehouse to, let's say, on its expedition to Hyderabad? Should I start it now, or should I start it later? What should be the transport connection? So it opens up a plethora of problem statement along with, like, and other could be, is that what kind of flexibilities can I offer to the customer given at given point in time, or given point in time of the order journey. So besides this, adding to that, there could be other problems like which is beyond my conversation here. It'll be about forecast, demand planning, supply planning, inventory positioning, inventory planning, and so on and so forth, which is not part of this conversation though. So how our journey started? The journey started with building workflows, because we are a scaling organization. At one point, our orders are increasing at 10x, 3x, 2x, and so on and so forth. So one end, we are building workflows, we are building our network, we are scaling our network in a very fast manner. So building workflows becomes a critical part. But while we are building workflows, the previous problem statement that we talked about, orders getting piled up in a big network and you're getting stuck everywhere, and your customers are getting a little bit angry about stuff of product not reaching their warehouse every time, right? So it's about extracting right data. So looking at this problem statement, we started from workflows. We want to instrument a lot of information. Instrumentation, some of the instrumentation we talked about, the lost mail, where how your fee is traversing, what is the geo data that we are getting. Apart from that, how are we managing our vendor relationship? How are our vendors performing? How is our sellers performing? What is their operating hours? How they model their information, etc. So we get into we were in a journey of modeling a plethora of data across the nodes or the factors that we talked about in the supply network. Then building awareness, it's an integrated awareness that becomes much more important to us. The integrated awareness in the sense that from all the way from last mile doing, in a last mile, if you're allocating an FE, how it replicates and come back to when should an order be released in a warehouse. So that awareness has to be integrated across the network. And that was one of the key points. And then employ some control levers in the network, right? Well, if I'm able to be awareness, I need to employ some control levers in the network. And if we need to deliver a product on a particular day, if 30 products is his capacity, that is some amount of levers and tools need to be provided to him for him to employ it. Otherwise, whatever that I do as an intelligent part will become shallow. Then the next part is about the building the intelligence itself, right? So we'll talk about more on the intelligence. But the overall goal of this theme is first is to become more an orderly and predictable execution. That's a goal that we want to achieve while we solve all these problems, so that we will be able to provide right answers to customer whenever customer walks to us. So now let me think about the logical view of it, right? So how did we go about building such amount of network intelligence? Step one is that we were, instead of building workflows, we stepped up and looked at building systems and processes and model systems and processes in the language of lead time and throughput. Every processes in the supply chain is modeled as a service entity, and above that, lead time and throughput of that is constantly defined. And every time there is a separate team that works on refining this lead time, making it much more efficient, and feeding back to the lead time and increasing the capacity part of it. Once we have this activities and process and lead time in our pocket, the second step is to build this into a customer view. Customer view is the next day delivery. The warehouse doing an operation of picking and packing a product. How does it reflect as in terms of next day delivery or same day delivery to a customer? Then above that, business and customer intelligence need to be coupled. So what services should be offered to what customers? What business is much more prone to what services? So it opens up that area for us. And having all these things lead to us in providing right service offerings and pricing to customers. So pricing is a very vast subject. We may discuss in subsequent sessions if possible. Here the idea is that having services, understanding customer need, understanding business need will enable us to offer right services with the element of pricing into it. So that leads to our customer choices. Now when you look into the other thing that we talked about is about the events and disruption that can happen across the network. So we need to build a real-time engine which can publish all the events and disruption that can happen across the network. One could be predictable, one could be unpredictable, or it could be scheduled like a bandh or so and so forth. So all this information comes through us. We started building a logistics insight module, which looks at all these disruptions possible in the world and funnel that information to any decision-making layer. Right? So this is one important concept. It's about demand prediction, right? In the context of Flipkart or marketplace, in the context of Flipkart, when we take an order, when we take a decision for a given order, right, it is an opportunity cost for the upcoming orders. So it is not only taking a decision for that particular order; it has to be treated holistically. If I can give you an example. For example, let's say we have one product in an inventory, and there are two customers walking in at time T1 and T2, and first customer could be a new customer, and second customer could be a very loyal customer to us, who is very high on the plus. How do we, if I am taking a decision at T1 for the incoming customer, I would have reserved that order to the customer, but may not be the right thing to do. Right? So keeping a demand prediction becomes much more important to us. And that's one area where we are investing heavily. All these things lead to generating some real-time fulfillment decisions. Right? So in the subsequent slide, we talk about, or maybe we take a talk one subject and see how the real-time fulfillmentation has been designed. Once you have a real-time fulfillmentation, we also have to operate those levers that we generated in the network by creating an orchestration across the network. So what is the orchestration elements that you have? You have arrows, you have people working on the floor, or you have your last mile hubs, you have transportation nodes, you have partners, and all these people are players in the network. And once you take a decision or a plan, once you create a plan for an order, then you need to orchestrate with these players in the node so that this can be, the goal can be achieved. And that's an example of the execution system. The execution system here could be a warehouse management system, or it could be a last mile management system, or it could be a transportation management system, or it could be all the way to the inventory planning altogether. Right? So this is the area what I call as network intelligence altogether. Execution system, so as we progress in our journey, in the initial days, we were heavy on the execution system, modeling those execution systems. And as we scale now and we look at with the power of more data in our hands, our investment goes heavy on the network intelligence part. So just to give a snapshot of how our systems look like, right? So there are a lot of building blocks in the entire plethora of FSG technology, which is supply chain technology in Flipkart. You will see a lot of asset systems like warehouse and all those things, and also you will also see location platform, location intelligence, network intelligence. We talked about logistics inside. We talked about how to get real-time events and funnel that to it. Between that, we have scheduled, unscheduled. We have people management. Like, we have a bunch of people who need to be skilled at various levels. So the skill management itself is a very big subject altogether. So all this information gets funneled by various modules and come to a box called real-time fulfillment decision maker. And that's why I call this fulfillment decision cockpit. From there, the decision and the plan for an order is created, and it comes down through a network orchestrator to all the way across to the execution systems. So that's a high-level system, quick view of it. So now, let me define what is network intelligence and orchestration means, given that we have this subject in the background. In a simple sense, it's a constraint-aware planning system. So what are the constraints? We talked about systems, process, lead time, throughput. Those are the constraints that we hear. And being able to plan on knowing this constraint itself is a big subject altogether. The second thing is that the decisions need to be taken in the subject of visibility of the entire network, of all the nodes, how they are moving, what are the things that's happening around the network, and also a notion of understanding what capacity they can do. If an FE walks into a hub, how many shipments can he handle, right? If he's a new FE, he could have handled very less number of shipments, or if it's an old FE, he can have much more shipments based on the location, etc. That's a capacity notion. All this information is much needed in order to take a real-time fulfillmentation. It also goes for an iterative planning. There are multiple events and disruption that's happening, either from the customer side or from the supply side. So all these events has to be funneled back to in order to take a right decision. So this defines what is network intelligence in English. Now, if you flow the orders again, let's say we have this concept of network intelligence, and if you want to flow these orders again, how does usually look like, right? So when the incoming demand, like the same kind of variation, it can come with a high level of variation. But what we do is that we don't push orders to the warehouse. We hold orders and take a decision whether it need to be fulfilled at a real-time manner or it should be fulfilled in a batch manner. This is done along with the batch order is not only with the order that is accumulated over till time, it also includes all the future orders that can be predicted based on our all changes that we are doing in the network. The second thing is about once we are able to understand the batch. An example of a batch could be is that I pick orders from warehouse only for the next transport connection, right? Or I could pick orders for orders from the warehouse only for the particular zonal areas where the products are located very close by, so that the picker's efficiency increases. So these are the multitude of signals that goes in before deciding a batch. And once the batch is decided, that goes for a planned picking. So the warehouse executive knows exactly what he need to pick at what location, right? And when he picks, it forms a story for the entire order path. And the sortation becomes much more simpler because I'm able to pick the orders in a very sequenced manner. It is for a particular sortation plan. If I look at the overall decision that I made, the decision is made for a overall order. The order scenario considers all the factors. So whenever I pick a product, it's for a certain sortation plan that is going to get, the sortation plan gets much more simplified in this thing. And also, I can since I'm taking a holistic decision, the routing becomes much more informed and much more educated, and I can always achieve a full truckload whenever I need, right? The implication is always better customer experience and significant reduction of cost. So that is the story that we are marching towards. And in the next few slides, what we will do is that we will see how a warehouse of an order gets selected or a batch get formed. Right? That will, so inventory is a, so every so we talked about a bunch of problem statement, what a fulfillment thing, for what a fulfillment system should take, and all the subjects in itself is very deep, and we will not have time to cover everything. So I have I want to talk more about how we do inventory reservation and release in the warehouse. So the question is, which warehouse to select given an order, right? So the first step that we do is that we don't take that point in time decision anymore. We hold order. We also have the orders that is accumulated till time. We also look at what are the future orders comes in. Then we prioritize among these orders. The prioritization comes from all the available warehouses and inventory, all the available warehouses and the inventory available in this warehouse across the seller included. So look at the list of this thing. Identify flow path choices. So given a batch, given this order segments, what are the multiple choices that is possible? So it is only it's a divergent problem thinking here. So taking an order, we look at all the choices of warehouse. From the choice of warehouse, we look at all the choices of flow path. So it is getting diverged. And then we look at, so every path has a cost versus SLA trade-off. Either I can minimize the cost or I can minimize the time to reach there. So the trade-off across every orders that need to be, that can be taken. And this orders has to be treated very specifically because one order, so for example, if you have ordered an iPhone X in Flipkart, you will demand fast delivery as a customer. Or if you ordered a T-shirt, which could come in 3-4 days, you don't wait for a T-shirt to come into your doorstep immediately, right? So there is a order wise and customer wise, all this the parameters that we talked about, the category wise, particular order wise, particular customer wise, gathering this context enables us to set the right priority for an order to take in cost versus SLA trade off. Then there is a risk in the supply chain, right? So we may have new partners who are new to the system, or it could be an evolved partner, they give better SLA but 50% of times. Or it could be a well-established product partner, and they may give a longer lead time but with high reliability. So assessing the risk along with that. And finally, before doing an inventory allocation, we also think about whether to allocate the inventory right away or not. So one is that the case that we talked about. If my match is prepared for a future, maybe tomorrow, I don't have to allocate right away because I can still get more information and decide the later point in time what need to be allocated. Or it could be the other way around, it's a plus customer and I do not want to derail his experience. I will allocate immediate inventory right away for that customer. Right? Or it could be pre-orders. And pre-orders is a concept in e-commerce where a book like Harry Potter book getting launched. In future, customers have placed an order right away. So I allocate the orders right away for them. So there's no deviation in his mind in terms of whether we'll get it or not. Now, if this concept lead to warehouse selection, how to batch an orders, right? As usual, we determine the flow path for an order. Now, the important thing is that once you determine the flow path, now there are areas where we have levers to place our transport connection on a network, right? So how do you balance your transport? Should from Bangalore, should I operate all the south zone, south destinations in the morning, or should I operate in the evening? How do I balance this network? Once I do the balancing of the network from Bangalore, I'm connected to all the way across the country. So if I'm balancing the network, how will I group this network so that the sortation plan can be devised properly? If I'm able to do the sortation plan, now I do a backward propagation across all. So starting from the last mile, we think about when the product has to reach the customer, then work backwards and figure out what is the latest time I need to release this order inventory into the warehouse. Once I determine that, I also do a forward propagation because releasing at the latest point means there is no queues in the network or no piling up in the network, but it can any disruption can affect this order much more. And also, if there is no enough demand for a particular day, I am making people, I sit idle, right? So which means that utilization can go down. So one is a backward propagation, then also we do a forward propagation. The goal of forward propagation is to figure out what is the earliest time I need to release an order into the warehouse, which includes the goal here is to see how I can maximize the utilization of the current resources that I have, right? And also the minimize risk. So this is the pointers of pointing question to us about how to selective warehouse or how to batch an order in a warehouse. All these things lead to us building custom algorithms. So we have defined a lot of algorithms in every subject. In the next slide, we may talk about one area, or what are the parameters going inside, etc. So this has led to us build a lot of custom algorithms in the network intelligence layer. So now, if I think about only modeling warehouse selection as one of the problem statement, how did we go about solving that problem? Like we talked about what are the parameters lead to selecting a warehouse. Now, if I think about how will I model this in a real time scenario? First is that everything has a business value. So what are the operating levers here? Either it is speed in terms of delivery SLA, or it could be cost into the actual opportunity cost that we are looking at. And it is also the risk involved in managing any of the product across our network. So all these things has to be modeled to a common business value. Right? An organization may take a step of increasing the speed so that it increases the conversion, it increases GMV, or reduce cost so that I increase my CM. Right? All these parameters, so this, the business value is a point in time or a point in time strategic decision where the prioritization of any of these things happen and come to a common unit of business value. The objective function is to maximize the value of a batch of orders. If I'm creating a batch of orders, it has a maximum value. The parameters that we consider is that, for example, if an order is given an order, what is the cost curve of an order? If it flow through multiple paths, if I decide a path, what is the cost of serving the path? If I don't decide, then if I take an order and if I ask the order to wait for some more time, what is the cost of losing that order or the future value of the order? So that is a cost curve of an order that we determine. And then cost of serving an order determined from the common one is that I can delay the order as much possible so that I can reduce the cost of serving this order. But there's a probability that the order can get canceled or it can derail some customer experience. The other end of the spectrum is I can go only looking at the order and look at the minimum cost of serving the order. Now there's a commonality between these two points and that determines our minimal cost of serving an order. The opportunity cost versus actually serving that order, that commonality comes as a cost of an order or flow path. Once we identify this cost of the flow path, we start modeling the risks associated with this. Then the second two steps are much more simpler. Identification of path, which is just an orchestration path, and identification of arrows, which is again following the simple plan. So this is how just to summarize some of the conversation that we had, right? We talked about the landscape of e-commerce. We talked about different products that get operated. We also talked about the supply nuances, what is supply chain network means. We also talked about what are the problem with scale when we don't have an intelligent network orchestration. So we also defined what is the network intelligence and how did we how a overall network intelligence as a concept sits into overall scheme of things in the technology stack. Then we also looked at a lot of problems that need to be addressed before serving an order. We zoomed into one particular problem statement, which is warehouse selection as such. And then we talked about what are the parameters that gets into before selecting a warehouse. Right? So that's it from my side, folks, and questions.
Hi.
Hi.
So my question is slightly tangential, but I feel like you're the right person to ask. In terms of the whole supply chain that you described, there's also the key element of people management that you touched upon at some
Absolutely.
Point.
Yeah.
Now, my concern or the question is that there's regulatory compliance in terms of labor laws,
yeah.
and there's also a human resource need in terms of making sure that all of the people working for you are in a good state to work.
Right.
So at a very basic, simplistic level, if you could tell me how many hours are FEs required to work and how do you cap it? Like what drives the decision? And what other kinds of people or human-centered constraints are put into consideration?
So let me start with the first problem statement that you mentioned about the human constraint that we face, right? So our warehouses are kept at very different locations. It's not part of the center of the city. So it's all outside the city just because of the space cost that is involved in it. So for every warehouse that is operating outside, there is a working timing that need to be defined as per the compliance law. It cannot be 24/7. If it is 24/7, there is a rate, the salary increase has to be significantly higher for the remaining part of the day. And also there should be transportation solutions should be there for these employees to go up and down. And second thing is about the safety nature includes employing medication facilities, medical facilities near the large warehouses that we operate. So and also other laws applies in a warehouse scenario. For example, there could be recreational facilities for a longer continuous work time. We not a law, but it is our way of encouraging the to reduce the fatigue of these employees. We also have recreational facilities and other things that we consider as a part of the layouting of a warehouse itself. Example of a warehouse. The second is about when you look at the employee timings in the logistics side. It's a usual 8-hour shift that we manage. We have an 8-hour shift, and there is a OT, overtime paid for the remaining 2 to 3 hours that we extend the thing as per the laws, defined by various geographies of India. So we follow that thing.
Yeah. Like, how do you measure an FE's efficiency, for example?
Sure. So given time, so it is about not about the number of products he deliver on a particular day. It's about the number of products he can deliver given a time period of a day. And also, it was about the geographical nuances. For example, as our system knows, based on the heuristics, we know that FE can deliver n number of products in a particular geographical locality, given the address and given the location of these addresses. And then we use that as a metric to measure the productivity of the FE, not the other way around.
And relating it back to the morning's talk about address failure and geolocation issues, whenever there is technology failure in that sense, how does that fall upon the FE, or how much does their feedback count, and how do you improve upon it, or what kind of costs does an FE bear for infrastructure failure?
I may not be best position. Aditya, you want to take this question, or should I go ahead?
Hi, my question is on, you spoke a little bit about modeling risk. So I wanted to ask what kind of risks are you looking at, and if you can give some detail on how do you attempt to model it?
So the risks are twofold to start with. One is the product risk itself. So if I'm taking a high value product, let's say it's an iPhone X, and for some reason the information is available that it's an iPhone X, so it induces any of the person who is handling the parcel to take his hands on it. So there's a risk on the product itself. The risk on the product is also under the second dimension of the risk is about the people who is operating that product. So if I have a high value product, let's say I'm operating jewellery for a hypothetical sake, and I'm doing a diamond jewellery order, right? There is a significant risk involved in moving this gold item or this jewellery item from one point to another point. So who are the parties that need to handle this product? What are the delivery nodes it has to, or what are the nodes it has to go through? It is based on the risk assessment of the subjects, like people as well as the facilities, the risk assessment of that. Now, the second part is about the risk of and people or the facility, if you look into it. From a risk perspective of people, we know the history of people. We don't, we have a background verification check across all our executives. We also know the tenure of the executives. So what are the remarks that he got from different transactions that he dealt with? So that information is all instrumented. Using those information, we extrapolate and figure out what is the risk of this person handling this product, right? The second is that about the facility or the nature of the location itself, right? If you come to Flipkart for say various geographic location, we don't deliver this product. High value products are not delivered to various geographic location. There are pockets that we have identified where we will not deliver the product beyond a cutoff. Beyond a value of a product, we don't deliver the product because the risk on that area itself is very high, where people know Flipkart employees, where they go and vandalize employees and collect the shipments. So we understand those pockets and we keep feeding into that real-time engine that I talked about. We store this information to take any risk-related assessment.